Welcome to Thursday's edition of COVID-19. There has been a decline in daily cases here in Korea today as we head into a long weekend, but authorities are underscoring the importance of vigilance as cluster infections continue amid a high death toll. I have Kwon Soa standing by with more on the local front as well as the latest on the international front. So now we are ending the work week with the tally in the triple digits here in Korea.
Yes, we are, Sunny. We are heading into the Christmas weekend with below 1,000 infections. 985 cases were reported this Thursday, and that is domestic transmissions at 955 and 30 imported cases. Now, compared to yesterday, we have 105 fewer numbers of infections. Now, on Wednesday, there's been a revision by 1,092 to 1,090 infections. Now, although we do have a drop here, throughout the whole week, we have mainly numbers in the triple digits, high 900s to the 1,000s as well. Now, for domestic transmissions, the daily average in the past week stood at around 980, which meets the criteria for the highest social distancing measures, which means level 3. Now, currently, the nation is under level 2 to 2.5 until the 28th, so there might be an announcement regarding the social distancing measures level on the weekend. Now, most places across the country are seeing double-digit figures or even triple-digit figures of daily infections, such as here in the capital, Seoul, 319. And those broke out at medical facilities such as nursing homes, as well as the military and places of worship. And 150 cases out of the total number of cases, that's around 15.7%, those were detected by temporary screening centers in the metropolitan region, and over 50,000 of those tests are being conducted on a daily basis recently. That's about the same number as the number of tests elsewhere at regular centers. And that's also a place where authorities would like to see long lines over the holiday as well, but not elsewhere, because beginning today, the special antivirus prevention period begins so that the virus will not spread over the holiday. So that means no social gatherings of five or more people, rather staying at home and not traveling. And this, of course, as the country is now dealing with over 53,500 infections and also the death toll at double digit on a daily basis, we also have over 15,000 people who are currently under treatment for the virus.
Right, so there appears to be some positive news, though. Ahead of Christmas, the government has announced its progress on the procurement, I hear, of COVID-19 vaccines. Tell us more.
That's correct, Sunny. So following Korea's contract with AstraZeneca before, the government has now signed deals with Johnson & Johnson's Janssen, as well as Pfizer, to import their COVID-19 vaccines as well. So here are the details by Prime Minister Chung Se-kyun.
We have signed a deal for 6 million doses from Janssen, which is 2 million more than what we initially planned for, and those vaccines are expected to be administered starting in the second quarter of next year. As for Pfizer's vaccine, we have agreed on a contract for 10 million doses, and they may arrive in Korea in the third quarter of next year.
Now, Chung added that there are negotiations underway to fast-track the shipment of the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine to the second quarter. And he also reiterated that the government will make sure that citizens can be vaccinated as soon as possible and also as safe as possible. Now, inoculations are happening already around the world, but mainly in the countries with the highest numbers of infections, like the U.S., Russia, as well as the U.K., and also Mexico has begun its vaccination program earlier this week, while India is getting prepared as well. Now, let's take a closer look at the highest increases on a daily basis. Over 230,000 here in the U.S., and we are seeing spiking figures in the U.K. due to the COVID-19 mutation over there. And that's also the reason attributed to the rise in South Africa. And there are now reports coming out that say the mutation here might be even worse than in the UK. And there are concerns that past Christmas we might have a total number of over 80 million cases, as we have 79 million right now around the world, and also daily deaths are at over 13,000. And those are the updates I have for now. Have a safe Christmas, and I'll be back on Monday. Sunny?
All right, Sua, thank you for that. It looks to be a quiet Christmas this year amid restrictions to curb COVID-19. I have our Jessica Lee out on location to offer us a glimpse of the change in sights and sounds of this year's celebrations. Hello, Jessica.
Good afternoon, Sunny.
Jessica, do you start by telling us where you are?
Yes, I am standing in front of Myeongdong Cathedral in Chung-gu District. It's Christmas Eve here in South Korea, and at this time of the year, a large crowd used to attend the various events from the cathedral to share this joyous occasion. However, as you can see here, it's relatively quiet around here due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Moreover, starting from today, the government has announced extra strong COVID-19 prevention measures for upcoming holidays, covering the Christmas Day and New Year's Day. Therefore, Myeongdong Cathedral is also joining efforts to get COVID-19 under control again. So every mass and other events such as Christmas concerts or Christmas talk shows will be held virtually from today to the 26th. Even though events are reduced in numbers and they will be held online, we have a large Christmas tree here and also gardens decorated with the of course, we have a manger. A manger of baby Jesus is actually installed in front of Myeongdong Cathedral every year. However, we have another one here in front of Catholic Hall Square. The reason why we have another one here is to have more people meet a baby close during this hard time amid the pandemic. And if you look closely, we have a special sculpture here. It's a sculpture especially symbolizing a COVID-19 screening center. How is it? Does the image of a COVID-19 screening centers come to your mind once you look at this blue and white sculptures? And if you look at this tree, it's decorated with plastics. And the reason why it has plastic decoration is to reduce disposable products that cost by COVID-19 situation. For example, by using plastic cups of delivery services while having a self-quarantine or following social distancing measures. Like this, it has a special meaning in it, and of course these decorations make it feel quite Christmassy. I believe everyone is having a difficult time and a difficult year-end. However, please have a great holiday with your family at home. But please do remember that no more than 4 people can gather, whether it's indoors or outdoors. So have a Merry Christmas and please stay safe. This has been Jessica Lee reporting live from Myeongdong Cathedral in Chung-gu District. And back to you, Sunny, in the studio.
All right, Jessica, thank you very much for that coverage. And to our viewers here, we do apologize for the disruption in audio connection. Up next, we are poised to join the regular briefing on COVID-19 here in Korea for this Thursday. And while we wait for that to commence, here are a few reminders about some of the new prevention measures that are in effect nationwide as of today until the 3rd of January next year. Now, social gatherings of 5 or more people are banned in the metropolitan region, while they are strongly discouraged in the rest of the country. Restaurants nationwide, however, for their part, cannot accommodate groups of 5 or more diners. The exception to this regulation includes those who live together as registered in their official documents, meaning a family of 5 or more who are registered under the same residential address can dine together. Meanwhile, also an exception to the restriction on gatherings is that related to business as well as weddings and funerals, where the cap on attendance stands at 49 or fewer, but 29 for funerals here in the capital city. Also, universities face a limit with regard to testings for new applicants, with 49 or fewer allowed at any one venue. All ski resorts have been closed, as have all tourist destinations nationwide. The closure comes in light of efforts to discourage the gatherings, that is, of large crowds that pose the risk of cluster infections. Meanwhile, reservations at hotels and other accommodations nationwide face a capacity limit of 50%. Tough penalties are in place, as seen on the screen, for those who violate these new regulations, with fines of a maximum of 3 million won. The briefing is about to start, I hear. We'll come back to you afterwards.
코로나19 Let us now begin a regular briefing on the COVID-19 situation here in South Korea. As of December 24th, we have a total of 955 new local infections and 30 new imported cases. And the total case load now stands at 53,533. Currently, we have 15,352 people in quarantine, while 291 are in severe or critical conditions. And also, we had 17 additional fatalities, and the accumulated death toll now stands at 756. I extend my deepest condolences to the deceased and the members of the bereaved families. And let us now go over our major updates on our domestic infections by region. First of all, in the Gwangju city in Gyeonggi-do province, in relation to a special school, we have also 16 additional cases being confirmed. And in total, we have 17 cases being confirmed. And in Seoul's Gangnam-gu district, in relation to a second call center, we identified the first index case on the 20th of December, and we have identified 14 additional cases, and in total, we have a total of 15 cases being confirmed to date. And in Gyeongbuk, Gumi city, in relation to a second place of worship, we also have the first index case of and we have the 32 additional cases, and a total of 33 people have been confirmed to date. And in Gyeonggi-do province, in Paju city, in relation to a nursing hospital, we have the first index case being identified on the 19th of December. We have 10 additional cases, raising the total to a total of 11. And in Incheon Namdong-gu district, in relation to a family, we also identified the first index case on the 19th of December. We identified 14 additional cases, and in total, we have 15 cases being confirmed to date. And in Chungbuk Gwaesan County and Umseong-gun Jincheon-gun County, in relation to a hospital there, we also identified 20 additional cases, and in total, we have 145 being confirmed to date. And in Jeju-do Island, Jeju City, in relation to a religious facility, we have 19 additional cases being confirmed, and in total, we have 138 being confirmed to date. And in relation to the staff member guarding and secure for the security of the former President Lee Myung-bak, one person has been tested positive, and actually 10 people have tested positive while they were standing on duty at the detention center in Seoul. And we also identified additional testings of COVID-19, and we identified additional patients, and currently they are being treated at hospitals or are waiting to be moved to the hospitals. And as for these security staff members, all of the people are getting tested, and they are on self-quarantine. So if you need any further information for this specific case, we would like to give you more information upon inquiry to the spokesperson's office. We need to have a very close eye on the COVID-19 situation here in South Korea. And among the OECD countries, we are ranking in the very bottom place, together with New Zealand, when it comes to the total tally of the COVID-19 cases. Of course, we are having a very great burden on the medical facility and capacity. However, our medical capacity has not yet collapsed as of now. It is a very grave situation. However, it is therefore we need to also stay complacent and stay vigilant going forward as well. And we would like to thank all of the public for your participation. However, nevertheless, we are having daily cases of 1,000 on a daily basis. basis. And to this end, the quarantine authorities would like to apologize for these outbreak trends. Currently, we are going through a winter, which is also very very effective for the vaccines or the viruses, that is, to be proliferated and to spread. And however, I am most concerned about the people who are working on the front lines, and also the high level of fatigue among the people who are working as the epidemiological investigators. We need to remember that they are at the core of Korea's quarantine. Up until now, we had testing, tracing, and treating were actually the core of our quarantine measures, also together with the social distancing that has been practiced by the public. We believe that these are the very ground principles. And moreover, based on these principles, we were relying on scientific data, and we would also fight against COVID-19 going forward with these principles. We will be carrying out more testings to contain the further spread of the virus, and we believe that we need to look into whether these virus prevention measures are practically practiced in daily life, and therefore we need to highlight the public's public's participation in these measures. Tomorrow we will be celebrating Christmas Day. Nevertheless, there are many medical staff members who are exerting their full efforts to secure and to protect the confirmed cases and the patients. And we need to also apologize while appreciate their dedications. And moreover, we would like to have special messages for the public as for Christmas Day. We believe that tomorrow is a great festivity that we need to celebrate. However, please note that the situation here in South Korea is very serious and very grave. And thanks to my thanks also goes to the many churchgoers who have been sharing their love and also good-heartedness to the with the neighbors. However, we are seeing a rapid resurgence of the virus throughout the country. And during the weekend, during the year-end holidays, starting from today until the 3rd of January, please note that no religious gatherings should be held, and all of these gatherings need to be switched to online, and we also need to have a ban on gatherings like group meals. And these measures will also protect the churchgoers. However, it also is protecting those who are looking after the vulnerable class. And however, we are seeing that we need to also have an eye and highlight the importance of containing the virus spread through these community transmissions, and this is why we ask for your particular precaution and participation. And the quarantine authorities, especially during the special year-end holiday quarantine period, we will be carrying out more testings to contain the virus and to find potential patients. Thank you very much.
Right, that was Lee Sang-won with us this afternoon briefing. So are you in a hurry to head home earlier, but thank you for coming back.
Yes, I'm glad that I'm back. I guess I wanted to get safe home during the Christmas holiday. And safe is the keyword what Lee also just mentioned, because beginning today until January 3rd, we will be under a special antivirus prevention period over the holidays. So there was a particular message to churchgoers, because during that span, all religious services should be held online. So that's what we have to note. Especially with tomorrow being Christmas, not everyone will be staying at home taking a rest. The frontline workers will still have to battle the virus, and testing, treating, as well as social distancing, he said, are the core principles in containing the virus. And especially the government will focus on massive testings, because we are seeing cluster infections at schools, nursing hospitals, family gatherings, as well as places of worship that I just mentioned.
I see. All right, Sua, thank you very much for that. Have a safe weekend. See you Monday.
Too. See you on Monday.
Meanwhile, children and their parents will be happy to know that Santa Claus has secured an exemption from global travel restrictions, allowing him, his reindeer, and his sleigh of Christmas presents to fly into different corners of the globe. Now, this is according to the Finnish Foreign Ministry. For more on this merry news, I have Santa Claus live on the line. Hello, Santa.
Hello, my dear friends in Korea, here from Korvatunturi. Merry Christmas.
Right, Santa, thank you for that greeting to our viewers here. Now, do tell us a bit, Santa Claus, about the Christmas celebrations in your hometown in northern Finland.
Well, this is the most exciting day for me today. This morning, I opened my secret box with my key in my pocket, and that gave me an access to all the secret, magical secrets of Christmas. With them, I can fly around the world. Maybe you won't see me, but the Christmas will be there, and everyone here is getting excited.
Are people in Finland just as excited, Santa Claus?
Yes, everyone. This is the highlight of, and this has been the most peculiar year, so people are getting together and comforting each other, and love is on the air, you might say.
Santa, compared to last year, how busy are you this year?
Well, after all, Christmas, the idea of Christmas is the same as usual, having goodwill and sharing it. So we have had thousands and thousands of letters from children and adults all over the world, and we've been preparing for Christmas. And the wishes for hope and being together and sharing love have been more common this year. So we have been busy for preparing Christmas. Also, of course.
I understand, Santa, that this year your meetings with children have also been expanded to include virtual sessions for those facing travel restrictions. Please tell us more about this.
Yes, as you and me now, we are using technology, and also Santa has been taught by elves to use all kind of Instagrams and these connections with virtuals. So, for example, Finland's official guide tourist office made a campaign where children around the world could share their wishes, and I have been meeting other children and adults as well with these video connections, and technology helps us being virtual face-to-face, you know.
Right. Santa, like you mentioned, you receive millions of Christmas wishes from children around the world each year. Could you share with us your own wish for the year ahead?
Santa has always one gift that is special for me. It's the idea of sharing goodwill. And for example, and especially this year, the gift has to be more important to me, so that in the near future we can be together more often and see each other. And you can come here to Finland, visit me as person to person. So I hope everything will get in a way as used to be.
Right. All right, Santa. Thank you very much for making the time to speak to us at this hour, and do have a safe trip around the world this year as well.
Thank you, and Merry Christmas to you all. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Right. End of year festivities are also looking to be quite different this year, as many celebrate the occasion within the safety of their homes, allowing for some silver lining for bakers, we explain in this report.
The year 2020 is drawing to a close, and the month of December is usually a time of many festivities for Christmas and the New Year. However, the holiday season this year is shaping up to be a quiet one, with many outdoor activities and gatherings being strongly discouraged or banned outright, with colder temperatures fueling a global resurgence in COVID-19. To curb the latest outbreak, the Korean government has announced new restrictions on social gatherings, with any groups of five or more people being prohibited from getting together from December 23rd to January 3rd next year. In light of these new restrictions, many citizens have turned to virtual gatherings to share the holiday spirit with their friends and loved ones. The holiday season is often a busy time for bakers and others in the confectionery business, but all that has changed amid COVID-19.
전문 업체 불러서 주의하고 그다음에 전문 방역 업체가 장비를 줬어요. 그 장비로 오픈했을 때, 그 다음에 중간에 손님 한번 빠졌을 때, 그 다음에 마지막 마감 칠 때, 마감 칠 때는 전체 소독 다 합니다. 그리고 2층은 아예 다 폐쇄한 지는 좀 오래됐고 정부 지침이 있기 전부터 바로 폐쇄 들어갔어요, 저희는.
It's early in the morning and these bakers are already hard at work making fresh bread and pastries. It's a physically demanding job, enough to make them sweat even during the cold winter. Though it may appear otherwise, they say the workload is far lighter this time around compared to previous years.
작년에는 좀 많이 바빴어요. 화장실 가기도 힘들 정도로 많이 바빴는데 그래도 올해 들어서는 12월 달 되니까 작년만큼은 아니더라도 그래도 좀 많이 바빠지기는 한 것 같아요. 연말이라서 그런지 좀 바빠진 것 같아요.
Bakery sales have taken a serious hit, with consumer spending on the downturn across all sectors of the economy.
매출 상승을 안 해본 적이 한 번도 없었는데 솔직히 이번에 떨어질 때 보통 떨어진 게 아니라 좀 심하게 떨어져가지고 정말 힘들긴 했어요. 근데 다행히 12월 들어서 그래도 단체 주문 회식 안 하시고 단체 주문으로 많이 케이크를 집에서 홈파티식으로 많이 하나 보더라고요. 그래서 단체 주문이 많이 늘어가지고 그나마 이번에 숨통이 좀 트입니다.
With many restaurants and other venues becoming off-limits, people are opting to hold small gatherings at home, leading to an uptick in the sale of cakes.
아, 코로나19 때문에 어디 밖에 나가지도 못하고 그래서 여자친구랑 같이 연말에 집에서 케이크 먹으면서 파티하려고 케이크 보러 왔어요. 코로나19 빨리 끝나서 연말에 좀 밖에 나가서 다 같이 놀 수 있게 그랬으면 좋겠어요.
Spending a quiet holiday season at home this year with the people you love may not be such a bad thing after all, as we yearn for better things to come in the year 2021.
. 혼역별 트라우마 센터를 확대하고 내년까지 지자체 정신건강 전문 인력 496명을 정원하여 코로나 우울 심리 지원 기반을 강화하겠습니다.
Anxiety over COVID-19 is also fueling anger in some cases as related restrictions limit family gatherings, close businesses, and ban end-of-year celebrations. Indeed, the psychological toll of the prolonged pandemic is proving to be just as horrid as the virus itself. So how do we ensure our mental health? Now, to answer that question, I have Professor Che Ki Hong from Korea University. Welcome to the program, Professor Che.
Thank you for having me.
And I also have Professor Chung Sun-jae from Yonsei University. Pleasure to have you back, Professor Chung.
Thank you for having me.
Professor Chung, aside from the special end-of-year prevention measures that go into effect nationwide starting today, the guidelines under level 2.5 in the metropolitan region is poised to end next Monday. And there is much speculation that there'll be a potential extension of this level,
yes,
or that we might even raise it further to level 3. What are your prospects?
Well, yeah, currently the government has proclaimed like a little bit more upgrade level than 2.5, or what we say is like 3 minus alpha sometimes. And then in the Seoul metropolitan city, they have also banned the gathering of more than 5 people. And because we are facing a really difficult situation, I think the swift upgrade has been made by these authorities. Personally, I think the highest the stage of social distancing has already been implemented right now, I think. Well, there are some experts saying that we should proceed to more strict guidelines, such as stage 3, literally. However, I think the feasibility is questioned when you consider the social economic aspects. So, however, as we see, there are like 1,000 people occur for newly daily cases. And I think the downgrade of the current social distancing by 28th would not be possible. So I think at least it'll be maintained, this kind of situation.
Right, I see. Professor Che, now I hear you've been conducting a study on the psychological impact of the pandemic on the public. Please share with us your findings first.
Yes, we've been conducting a longitudinal study looking at the changes in depression and anxiety and risk for suicide every 2 months from May. So we have now four time points data. And as you know, we had the second wave pandemic in September. So at that time, our survey participants reported that about 40% of them experienced some levels of anxiety and depression, and about 20 to 30% actually heightened risk for suicide. And those statistics actually higher than those reported in May and July.
I see. Professor Che, are certain groups of people more prone to these feelings of depression?
So in our data, people in their 20s and 30s experience much higher levels of depression and anxiety than other adult age groups. And especially women in 20s and 30s experience much higher depression and anxiety than men.
Was there a reason for this finding?
I think it's a more complicated, but speculating some potential factors contributing to that. For women in their 30s, I think their daily activities and life goals are much more restricted because, you know, child care issues and homeschooling, and they have to be juggling with, you know, home, job, their families, and so those kind of things are very much difficult for them. And women in their 20s, I think job instability would be the most important factor, because a lot of traditional jobs and positions available for them is no longer available, such as, you know, aviation or food and service industry, something like that. So I think we have to take a look at any gender inequality in terms of the job positions and availability. We have to be carefully monitor those kind of things.
Right. It has been said that almost 10,000 jobs will be lost this winter season because of the closure of ski resorts as well.
Exactly.
Professor Chung, you also launched research on the psychological toll of COVID-19 on patients as well as medical professionals. Now, I would assume that the toll on those at the front lines would be much more severe. Tell us about your findings and their implications.
Actually, in the August of this year, we have surveyed about 600 medical staffs in the Chungcheong area, and from the four hospitals, and these hospitals were exclusive for treating COVID-19 patients only. And in our study, we have found that 50% of the people, the participants, the medical staffs, were suffering from severe level of burnout, or we say emotional exhaustion. And also, when considering there's a female medical staffs and also nurses, they show like 80% of burnout. And this was a very serious situation for us too. And when we correlate some factors to this kind of severe burnout, people who had the higher education level or had a longer working period or maybe having the previous mental or health issues, they had more higher rate of this burnout too. And when predicting this burnout for the mental health problems of this medical staffs, their anxiety about self infection and worries about the family members was the major issue. So in our result, we suggested that the such environment that should be guaranteed for the medical staffs for their regular break or recess or leave. And also there should be some system for them, the medical staffs, to regularly communicate with their family members and saying that they're okay.
Professor, you mentioned about a higher level of depression for those who come from a high educational background. Is there a reason for that?
Because at the beginning, and actually we ran another survey from March until now, and in the beginning, there was a higher rate of anxiety from the high educational people, and I think they know about this seriousness. They were alert to the news and other kind of sources from the information.
I see. Professor Che, those who have suffered, who have survived, that is, COVID-19, speak of prolonged side effects. What would be some of the side effects that affect them psychologically after their fight with COVID-19?
Yeah, in our survey data, we have very small number of COVID-19 patients, but they reported doubled depression and anxiety symptoms. And the recent report published in Lancet in November this year, about two times more COVID-19 patients were diagnosed with a diagnosis of mood disorders or anxiety disorders and dementia than non-COVID-19 patients.
I see. I understand that you spoke about the danger of dismissing such side effects. Could you explain about that as well for us, the dangers of dismissing these psychiatric side effects of COVID-19?
Yeah, definitely. I think the survivors and people survived and recovered from COVID-19 actually had, I think, quadrupled risk for mental health and physical health issues. Because, you know, they lose a lot of social support, and also they have to deal with a lot of uncertainty, like difficulty getting back to their daily routines. And sometimes a few people may experience some traumatic experiences in diagnosis and treatment kind of process. So I think they have a lot of, you know, psychological sequelae and difficulties because of those several quadrupled kind of risk.
I see. Professor Zhang, what would be the potential impact of such psychological feelings ranging from anxiety to anger on the spread of COVID-19?
Yes, according to previous literatures, the emotional state or this kind of mental health issues in public population is very important for the national quarantine. Because if for example, for a confirmed patient, when he experiences severe anxiety or panic, then the treatment compliance goes down. So there are many chances to spread the virus by patients rejecting this kind of treatment options. And also, there is a high probability of virus contacts, and when they feel anger or depression or like anxiety, then they won't follow the isolation guideline as well. And in addition, in the general population, the normal people, when they are subjected to this kind of anxiety or high excessive stress, then this kind of complying with the quarantine guidelines, such as right now we have, like not gathering more than five, would not be made. So this is a really big issue for the public safety too. So in summary, the mental health status of this population is extremely important also as in the context of quarantine principles and public health.
Right. Professor Che, on a personal level then, what can be done to ensure one's mental stability amid this raging pandemic?
I would say that the COVID-19 prevention and control is most important. So from our longitudinal study, when we have very lower rates of infection, actually people had much lower anxiety and depression and risk for suicide. So that's number one thing we have to do. And the second thing, securing financial and job stability is important for everyone. So, and then third, I think the scientifically proven, evidence-based psychological services should be available to the public. So those kind of things are, I think, we have to do for preparation.
I see. Professor Zhang, meanwhile, then, what can authorities do, well, more that is, to ensure the public's psychological well-being?
Well, actually, to date, many authorities have been provided, like the Ministry of Health and Welfare, KDCA, or the National Center for the Mental Health. They have established hotlines, and also they made guidelines to individual level. So, for example, like in the guideline, there is a delivered effective personal maintaining regular life pattern, and also consulting with a neighbor when they feel in difficulties, and also focusing on things that people ordinarily liked. So this is really effective guideline for the individual level. And from my point of view, I think now we need more broader range, like more considering social and community level. So for example, perhaps the most important social implement should be made in coping with stigma about the confirmed cases. Well, as far as I know, the most of the confirmed cases, they are afraid of social blame instead of their biological progress or like death in this kind of COVID-19 confirmation. And this kind of stress would give like PTSD, loneliness, and other adverse mental health issues too. So in this regard, I think the government, public organizations, and the media should understand to help this confirmed patient's agony and reflect their perspective.
Right. Professor Che, is there a way to assess if whether the COVID-19 related feelings that one is experiencing, that is, require medical attention?
Yes. The institutes I belong to developed the scientifically proven screening tool for depression and anxiety and suicide risk. And those services are available at free and no cost at the Korean Psychological Association and also National Center for Mental Health. And also, those kind of testings could be available, should be available at the community mental health centers. So the people who have experiencing psychological distress can just go to the website, the Korean Psychological Association National Center for Mental Health. They can check the levels of emotional and psychological distress at no cost.
Right. Professor Chong, perhaps another factor fueling the psychological toll of the pandemic is the rampant presence of fake news. What can be done to keep oneself protected from this, from these distorted information?
Well, actually, from our longitudinal study, we have found that the people who spent more than 2 hours about daily searching for the COVID-19 news, they are more prone to have depressions, PTSD, anxiety. So in our research, we suggested that maybe for the general public, it should be recommended to get into to this searching information less than 2 hours daily would be adequate. And also, I would like to recommend, please think and please rethink about the information if this information was from the credible organization, such as KDCA or Ministry of Health and Welfare or WHO. And when dealing with the social media information, please have the ability to have the critically discern about the validity of the information.
Right. Professor Che, this is a rather impromptu question, but I was just wondering, given the presence of pandemic fatigue and the drop in compliance to social distancing measures because of the prolonged pandemic, some experts are calling for the media to perhaps share rather shocking images of the pain, suffering caused by COVID-19 to let the members of the audience understand the importance of social distancing measures. What are your thoughts on this method of raising awareness about the severity?
I think the increasing the anxiety might not much helpful. But anxiety itself is important because we can be prepared for potential threat. But if we have too much anxiety and have difficulty managing emotional distress, then we try to avoid any kind of reality and real risks. So I think we have to approach personally. So some people might be able to address those kind of things with some of the heightened levels of the danger or something like that. But at the same time, we can provide a much more personalized kind of intervention for them. So for example, free psychological, services available if they have a lot of, kind of confusion and anxiety or something like that. And then they can go to the free services available and they can consult with the professionals. So the professionals can provide personalized kind of intervention for them. So I think we have to combine those kind of public approaches and also more professionally driven and personalized kind of intervention.
Right. Yeah. Professor Chong, we are poised to head into a long weekend now, and what are some of the safety precautions that you would recommend for members of the public?
Yeah, it is tedious to say this on and on because I have always said this in the, you know, before too. But we are facing this major third wave, and the only three definite rules for us to have is that the first is wearing a mask. A second is washing hands, and then number three is keeping social distancing. So in particular, in Citizen in Seoul, we'll endure a very lonely holiday because we now have really strict regulations. However, I think it is important to remember that there are certain people who are suffering more in this situation, the same situation. So for, if possible, I would like to suggest everyone to think and thank about the people around ourselves. And scientifically, having gratitude is one of the most powerful ways to prevent depression and also build a psychological resilience to win over these difficult times.
I see, acknowledging a sense of appreciation for those around. All right, Professor Zhang, thank you very much for your thoughts. And Professor Che, thank you very much for being with us today.
Thank you very much, my pleasure.
Right, changes in scenery amid the pandemic does not necessarily mean changes in the spirit of sharing and caring this time of the year. So do seek to do so within the safety of your homes. Have a good weekend.
Fundraising events and charity campaigns are part of year-end rituals, but this year things are going to be a little bit different. COVID-19 has changed the way in which we participate in these kinds of events. Here's more on contactless donations.
A red kettle, a bell, and street fundraising.
우리는 코로나19로 인해 어렵고 힘든 가운데 있습니다.
The Salvation Army's red kettle is a symbol of sharing in winter. For the first time in 92 years, the Salvation Army held its red kettle kickoff ceremony online this year. Although the target amount has gone down, there are more ways to participate in the campaign. You can make contactless donations by using QR codes and transportation cards. When you scan your QR code, you'll be directed to a website where you can make a donation. Or you could just make a call or send a text to donate.
COVID-19 is also impacting year-end charity campaigns. But it's when things get tough that we need a little more warmth and love. Even a small contribution could help build the strength to overcome COVID-19.
Overcoming COVID-19 together. Let's all stick to the basics.
The international economic structure has been recognized for the post-COVID-19 era. Due to the rapidly changing global value chain, South Korea is working diligently to become a global economic hub by luring foreign companies to set up offices. Then, what are the forts of South Korea and what are some of the tasks at hand for this Asian nation? We find a solution by visiting a prominent foreign investment firm that had advanced to South Korea.
Hey everyone, I'm your host Henry, and welcome to another episode of KBiz. Today, I'm at a global company which succeeded immensely when entering the Korean market. Can you guys guess where I am? I'm at 3 a.m.
This company was founded in the United States in 1902, and it produces diverse products in various fields. It has no products in medicine, safety, electronics, construction, automobiles, and even personal protective equipment. The company was advanced into South Korea 43 years ago. 3M Korea manufactures and sells 17,000 different products in various outlets, including optical film, medicine, safety, and consumer items. 3M Korea's Technology Institute is located in Hwaseong City, Gyeonggi-do Province. You can see detailed application cases of all the fields at this institute. The first place I visited was the Personal Safety Solution booth. Diverse products like protective gear, masks, helmets for people working at industrial sites were on display.